Good morning. Welcome to worship on this beautiful Sunday morning. I'm glad to have Paul back from his vacation. Welcome, welcome home. Are you good and rested? And yeah. Okay. I'm grateful for Ted Berg filling in for me and leading worship last Sunday. This Sunday, Ted is up in Columbia Falls at Our Savior Lutheran doing the same thing up there. So we're praying for him as he leads worship there as well. Welcome to all of you. Anybody visiting with us for the first time today? Welcome. Good to have you here. For all of you, brand new or long-timers, we're grateful that you are here. We pray that the grace of Christ will meet you as you worship this day. We gather together to feed on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who is here, present with us, and promises to meet us. At the end of each pew, you'll find the red pew pad. Sometime during the service, would you be so kind as to sign in and pass that on down the pew? Our worship continues this morning with our entrance hymn, Lord Be Glorified. You'll find it in the bulletin. Please stand. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the creator of wind and rain, field and ocean, the bread of life coming down from above, the power at work within us and this world.
Amen.
Before God and in the company of our sisters and brothers, let us confess our sin. God and Father of all, we confess
that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed.
We have thought better of ourselves than others. We have told lies, said hurtful things, acted in ways we wish we could take back, and looked the other way when action was needed. In your mercy, O God, forgive us, cleanse us, and heal us, for the sake of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Hear the good news. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. Everything has become new. In Christ, you are a new creation. Your sins are taken away, and you are made new. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you. Amen. The grace of Jesus Christ, the mercy of the Holy One, and the Spirit of the living God be with you all.
And also with you. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. Let us pray. Ever-loving God, your Son gives himself as living bread for the life of the world. Fill us with such a knowledge of his presence that we may be strengthened and sustained by his risen life to serve you continually. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
The first lesson for today is from Proverbs, the 9th chapter, verses 1 through 6. Wisdom is portrayed as a woman who invites people to partake of her banquet. Just as ordinary food is necessary for physical life, wisdom's food, insight and understanding, is necessary for fullness of life with God. Partaking of wisdom's banquet is the way to life. A reading from Proverbs. Wisdom has built her house, she has hewn her seven pillars. She has slaughtered her animals, she has mixed her wine. She has also set her table. She has sent out her servant girls. She calls from the highest places in the town, "You that are simple, turn in here." To those without sense, she says, "Come, eat of my bread and drink of the wine I have mixed. Lay aside immaturity and live and walk in the way of insight." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. The psalm for today is from the 34th Psalm, verses 9 through 14. Please read with me responsively. Fear the Lord, you saints of the Lord, for those who fear the Lord lack nothing. The lions are in want and suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack nothing that is good. Come, children, and listen to me. I will teach you reverence for the Lord. Who among you takes pleasure in life and desires long life to enjoy prosperity? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from lying words. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The second lesson for today is from Ephesians, the 5th chapter, verses 15 through 20. True wisdom integrates our new reality in Christ with our Christian fellowship and daily conduct. Because we are filled with the Spirit, Christians regularly rejoice together, give thanks to God for one another, and care for one another. In this way, we revere our Lord Jesus Christ. A reading from Ephesians. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. As you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the Gospel.
The Holy Gospel for this day is written in John's Gospel, chapter 6. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, How can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, Very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. I invite the children for the children's sermon. Guys, this morning? Good. I'm glad. Have you ever watched cows eating? What do they do?
They stick their head down and
eat the grass. And then they'll lift their head up and they'll just go. Can you do that? Yeah. You guys are good. I like that. Okay. Yeah. And in fact, they've got, what, 4 stomachs so that they can bring it up again and chew on it some more and just keep all day long? Yeah, that's cows. Okay, so we've been spending, actually all month long, we've had gospel readings that call Jesus the bread of life. And we've been, I remember a couple of weeks ago, we were talking about how, well, if Jesus is bread, what do you do with bread? You eat bread. Are we supposed to eat Jesus? How does that work? And we started talking about that back then, yeah? Okay, we're still kind of pondering that and wondering about that. Give me the cow thing again. That's good. I like that. Okay, have you ever heard the expression, I'm going to chew on that for a while? You ever heard anybody say that? Do they mean that they're actually going to chew something? What do they mean? like think about it. Yeah, if you're going to chew on something, you'll be thinking about it for a while. And then it's not just in your brain, it's also in your heart. You're feeling it. You're kind of sitting with it. You're kind of living with it. It gets inside you and you get inside it. Yeah, you're going to chew on that for a while. Yep. Okay. So the very center of our faith as Christians is that Jesus died for us. Yeah? That Jesus gave his life for us. Everything else that we believe and live in centers around that. That Jesus gave his life for us. What would it mean to chew on that? You think, Jesus, you died for me. Thank you. Jesus, you gave your life for me. Thank you. Yeah. And the more we chew on that, the more we live in that, it's not just that we think it and we feel it and we spend time with it, but Jesus actually comes inside us. He comes in us and he invites us into him in some strange way. We're part of him and he's part of us. And we live because he died. That's what this is all about. So he's inviting us to chew on him, to take him in and us into him. And as we chew on his death for us, we live. We live. Would you pray with me? Dear Jesus, thank you for giving your life for me. Thank you for dying for me. We love you, Lord. It's much too much for us to take in. But we believe you and trust you and love you. Help us to chew on you our whole lives. In your name, Jesus. Amen. Thank you. Our sermon hymn this morning is one that's brand new to me. Maybe some of you know it. I didn't know it yet. So I've asked Paul if he will play through the melody for us so we can hear it once clearly before we try and tackle it ourselves. Number 637. How to Go. That was a tricky one, wasn't it? The words are great. The music was a little tricky. Okay. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. All summer long for our hymn of thanksgiving, after communion, we have been singing the last verse of a new communion hymn. The key line in that last verse is, we become what we receive. Have you been noticing that all summer? We become what we receive. Here's the whole verse. Send us out with faith and courage to the hungry, lost, bereaved. In our living and our dying, we become what we receive. Christ's own body, blessed and broken, cup overflowing, life outpoured, given as a living token of your world, redeemed, restored. We become what we receive. It's another way of saying you are what you eat. In communion, in the Lord's Supper, Jesus gives us himself, his body and blood, his life and death for us, his resurrected life for us. And as he gives himself to us, we become what we receive. We become Christ's own body, blessed and broken for the world. Well, we have been in Bread of Life land all month long. In this year, when most of our gospel readings come from the Gospel of Mark, these five Sundays veer off into John instead and immerse us Sunday after Sunday in the theme of the bread of life. So in case the message hasn't gotten through yet after all of these weeks, Jesus is the bread of life. Jesus is the nourishment that God gives us from heaven to give life to the world. Last Sunday, Ted Berg filled in for me. Thank you, Ted. It's the first time Peggy and I have ever listened to worship on the radio and heard the preacher addressing us by name. Sometimes you think the preacher is talking straight to you. I bet you've never had it happen quite that literally. Well, last Sunday, Ted really underscored it. Jesus is the bread of life, and his gift is, as you were all repeating over and over, his gift is forever. You remembered. Good for you. Five Sundays on the bread of life. But there is a progression through this long chapter of John. There's movement that goes on. And the movement is that Jesus keeps intensifying his claim and his invitation. And each time he ramps up his claim, it gets more confounding and more offensive. Next week, in fact, we will hear the people react to what Jesus says today. What they'll say is, this is a hard teaching. Who can accept this? That's next week. Marlene, that one's yours. Jesus keeps ramping up his claims step by step, and as he does it, he has to know that he's offending people. He has to know that he is shocking people. Why does he do it? What's he trying to accomplish? And his offense is not just history. It's not just those poor folks back then that didn't know any better. Our world today is every bit as offended by Jesus' claim. And maybe sometimes we ourselves are as offended by Jesus' claim. What is he up to? Let me take you back through the progression. We were there among the crowd. We were among the 5,000 that Jesus fed with one boy's lunch. We track Jesus down again the next day, only to have him challenge our motives. He says, you're not here because you read the sign. You're here because I filled your bellies and you want some more. He challenges us then to seek the bread that lasts for eternal life and says that he can give it to us. Well, we like that idea, but we're no dummies. We weren't born yesterday. We're not going to take every huckster that comes along the way. And so, of course, we're going to check out Jesus' credentials. How can this guy claim to give us the bread of life? Now is when he ramps it up the first step. He says, I am the bread of life. Come to me and you will never hunger or thirst again. That's the first shock. It's one thing for Jesus to claim to be our spiritual teacher, our guru. It's another thing for Jesus to say, I can offer you the bread of life. I can teach you how to find it. I can train you to receive the bread of life. It's another thing entirely for him to claim, I am the bread of life. Our world is filled with spiritual teachers and gurus and mystical masters, adepts who can train us to advance in our spiritual lives. We can pick and choose the ones we like. We can attend this conference or read that book or follow those five steps or take this training program. But I am the bread of life. Now we're moving from a teaching to a person. What would that even mean for Jesus himself to be the bread that gives life to the world? And as we stand there in the crowd and listen to Jesus' claim, we can hear the grumbling all around us, and maybe it's inside us as well. Where does this guy get off? We know him. We know his family. He's just another schmuck like the rest of us. How can he claim to have come down from heaven and be the bread of life? Jesus' response, he says, I know you can't all accept this. You can only accept it, in fact, if God breaks through and draws you to me. If God is teaching you, if God breaks through to you, you will come to me. And that only makes us bristle all the more. If I can't accept Jesus' outrageous claim, then apparently I'm not listening to God. How offensive is that? Now Jesus ramps it up one more notch. This is the verse that concludes last Sunday's reading and begins today's. Jesus says, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. My flesh. Time for a full stop. Do you hear what he's saying? First, he's repeating his already outrageous claim that he not only offers the bread of life, but is the bread of life, and that if we eat of that bread, we'll live forever, that if somehow we take Jesus into ourselves, if somehow we consume him and make him part of us, we will live forever. We may balk at that claim, we may struggle with it, but on some level we can start to make some sense of it. Bread is a metaphor. Jesus is inviting us somehow to feed on who he is, and that will give us life. Well, that's challenging enough, but this is the piece that he adds. The bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. Now what? Do notice, by the way, how broad Jesus' reach is, how universal his gift. The bread that I give for the life of the world. This is to be worldwide. But the clinker is, that bread is my flesh. What does that mean? Jesus' physical body, his physical life in the world, the meat on Jesus' bones? As we stand there in the crowd, I don't know what sort of sense we can make of Jesus' claim. At the very least, he seems to be directing us away from most of the world's spiritual systems of accomplishment. For so many of us, spirituality suggests that we move away from the body, away from the world, away from the physical and the tangible, away to the heavenly and the mystical, away to a realm untouched by body and mind and dirt and struggle. But Jesus? Nope. No, the bread is my flesh, my physical life in this world. We could never have guessed standing there in that crowd. Either of these two things. First, the bread of life is his own physical life in this world, his incarnation, his becoming human, God's own total embrace of our humanity in Jesus' humanity, that Jesus is born like us, grows up like us, learns and develops and struggles and plays like us, faces temptation and pain and loss like us. The bread of life is Jesus' own human life among us, living out what it means to be truly human and living as the face of God in this world. And second, this bread is a bread that Jesus will give. The bread that I will give for the life of the world, that's the cross. Jesus knows where he's going. His bread is his life given for us at the cross. His bread is his supreme act of love for us, laying down his own life for us. So here's his claim and his invitation. He himself is the bread of life. He calls us to take him into ourselves, and more specifically, his life for us and his death for us. That's the bread of life. Eat my life. Eat my death. And you will live. Well, no surprise by now, the crowd is reeling. We are reeling. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? And now Jesus gives it full throttle. He ramps up the offense so that it's nearly unbearable. He says, "Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you." Eat your flesh, Jesus? How could we have heard this? And worse yet, drink your blood after all those Old Testament chapters where God prohibits all consumption of blood? How can you ask us to drink yours? Time for a parenthesis. This piece of the conversation that we have for our gospel reading today, these verses, they're filled with language about eating Jesus' flesh and drinking his blood. We are Christians, and we, especially as Christians who share communion every Sunday, when we hear these words, we can't not think of communion, right? We can't not think of the Lord's Supper. When Jesus spoke these words, however, communion didn't exist yet. The Lord's Supper hadn't been invented yet. Jesus was going to institute it on the last evening of his life. Is he trying to teach about communion in advance before he gives the gift? Maybe. Here's how I'd rather say it. I don't know if it makes sense, but here's how I would rather say it. It's not so much that Jesus is talking about Holy Communion here. It's rather that Holy Communion ties us back into what Jesus is talking about here. It's not that this is about the Lord's Supper. It's rather that the Lord's Supper is about this. I don't know if that makes any sense or not. Part of what drives me to that, though, is Jesus' offensive language. If Jesus is trying to teach about communion, why all the offensive language? First, he talks about not just this is my body, but eat my flesh. Second, he adds that, by the way, drink my blood as well. And third, in today's verses, Jesus adds a new verb. All throughout this chapter up until now, he's used the normal verb for eating that we always use. Now he uses a different one, four times. To chew, to munch, to nibble, to gnaw on his flesh. It's about as graphic as you can get. So listen to the offense and the promise. Whoever chews my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. You like that promise? Those who gnaw on my flesh and drink my blood dwell in me and I in them. Whoever munches on me will live because of me. The one who chews this bread will live forever. Jesus, why do you keep ramping up your claims? And why do you put it this way? You have to know how offensive it is. Why are you doing it? What are you trying to accomplish? If we heard anyone else making claims like Jesus makes here, we would lock them up, right? If we had been standing there that day in Capernaum, I'm guessing we would have reacted just like those folks did. This is outrageous. Jesus, your claims are outrageous and downright disgusting. Unless, of course, he's right. Unless he's telling us the truth. And he is who he says he is. If Jesus really is the I Am, if he really is the face of God here in this world, rubbing shoulders with us, if Jesus really is living out God for us so that we can finally see and hear and touch and taste what God is all about, if Jesus really is God become human to live out also what true humanity is all about, if it's all true, then he's not just handing out the bread of life, his spiritual teachings alongside the teachings of all of our other spiritual masters. Then he's not just an example for us to emulate. Then he's not just here to teach us how to add a little spiritual depth to our already comfortable lives. If it's all true, then Jesus is overturning everything. He's overturning all of our spiritual projects. He's canceling out all of our attempts to remove ourselves from this world of hunger and struggle and dirt and earthiness. If it's all true, then Jesus' own flesh, his living with us and for us, his dying with us and for us, Jesus' own flesh is the food that we are so hungry for. If Jesus' claims are true, then the food that we so desperately need is a God who joins us in our earthiness and brokenness and pain, a God who gives his own life for the life of the world. If Jesus' claims are true, then to feed on Jesus, to chew on his life, to gnaw on his death, to munch on his resurrection, to feed on the flesh of Jesus, to eat and drink his death, that is life. That is life. Here are his promises, four times over. Chew on me and you have eternal life. Gnaw on me and you dwell in me and I in you. Digest me and you will live because of me. Consume me and you will live forever. Jesus, why do you have to make it so offensive, so graphic, so gross? Is that the only way to pull me away from all of my spiritual snacking and fantasy? Is that the only way to show us how confused we've been? Is that the only way to bring us to your cross, to that offense that overturns all of our human projects? Well, it is offensive. The claim of Jesus is offensive. It flies in the face of all of our self-sufficiency. It tells us that we have it all backwards. Left to our own devices, we will hear him and we will shake our heads and say, no thank you, and back away. But if we hear him and let his offensive language do its work and stay for the meal, then we discover that his promises are true. And then here's what happens next. We become what we receive. We are what we eat. We become what we receive. Our own lives get turned little by little, right side up again. In our living and our dying, we become what we receive. Christ's own body, blessed and broken, cup o'erflowing, life outpoured, given as a living token of your world redeemed, restored. Are you ready for that? Are you hungry? Then come to the table. Come and eat. Amen. Trusting in this one who is our bread and our life, let's confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. With confidence in God's compassion and generosity, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of God's creation.
Lord Jesus, you are the bread of life. You give us your life. You give us your death on the cross. You give us your resurrection. You give us your spirit. Turn us, Lord, from all our false, empty food. Open us to receive you, to feed on you, and to live in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, bread of life, as you feed us with your flesh, your life and your death, transform us so that we become what we receive, your own body, blessed and broken, given as a living token for the life of the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, bread of life, look upon your world hungry for food, hungry for safety, hungry for hope, hungry for your saving love. Look upon your world with compassion and call us to your side. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, bread of life, we ask your blessing and guidance as we search for a new youth and family director. Lead us, Lord, and prepare the heart of the person you have in mind. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. In this season of massive wildfires, Lord, we ask for your help and your protection for those who fight the fires and those whose lives are in the path of the fires. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, bread of life, heal your people. Today we name before you Don Phillips, Catherine Halverson, Ella Anderson, Earl Holst, Glenn Ossheim, Rochelle Rabiner, Clarice Amundsen, S.G. Mack, Bob Lestofka, Randy Wood, and myself, and those that we name in our hearts. We ask your loving presence and your resurrection promises for the family of Bernice Gokenauer and for all who live in grief this day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Into your loving hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abundant mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share God's peace with one another.
God's peace, array.
Peace to you.
God's peace.
God's peace. Peace to you. Peace to you.
God's peace with you.
God's peace.
God's peace to you.
God's peace to you. Peace to you. God's peace. Thank you. Please stand.
Let us pray. Bounteous God, as you receive these gifts, receive our hearts and our lives. Bless those who bring these gifts today. Deepen their faith, kindle their joy, and free them to walk with you. In Jesus' name.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and places give thanks to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and light, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hear the gospel. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it for the remembrance of me." Abba, Father in heaven, seated. This morning, as you come for communion, you'll be coming by way of the side aisles. The first person that you come to will have a wafer for you. There are also gluten-free wafers on the baptismal font. You'll dip the wafer either in the first cup you come to, that wine, or the cup in the center, which is grape juice, and return by way of the center. Everything is ready. Your Lord bids you come.